it's the antidote to that. It's the justification for it.
Yeah.
It's not a distraction. It can't be a distraction. Because if it's a distraction, it won't work. You know, generally people distract themselves with trivialities. You know, with cheap, impulsive entertainment. And I don't have anything against even cheap, impulsive entertainment for that matter. But it's not something that you do while you're busily suffering yourself into extinction. It's like, I do believe that, I believe that there's evidence for this, that the instinct of meaning is the deepest instinct that you have, and that it actually does orient you to the proper place, whatever that means. It means something biological, it means something political, it means something economic, but I think it means something universal as well. Because I do think that consciousness plays a central role in being. And so if you orient yourself towards what's meaningful, then you participate in all those levels at the same time. Now, I don't know what the ultimate significance of that is, but I suppose it's the same as the ultimate significance of reality itself. But there's something profound to it. It's not just a distraction by any stretch. Like, I don't think we're fiddling away while Rome burns. I don't think you find pleasant occupations to preoccupy yourself while you trudge towards death. You know, it's not like that. It's the orientation towards meaning is a fundamental reality. You're neurologically wired that way, and so it's real. Now, what that means ultimately, I don't know. But one thing I do know that it means is that it means less hell, and that's something, right? Really, that's something. So we can start with that and see where it goes. Yeah.
So interesting.
Sure, if you stand up, then everybody can hear you.
All right, all right.
Yeah!
So I'm 17, and I'm going to be going to university soon, and your lectures were part of the reason why I decided to make my intended major neuroscience,
yep.
Kind of an emphasis on neuropsych.
Yep.
And I was just wondering, in terms of like the canon of psychological works, you know, Freud, Jung,
yep.
Rogers, does it matter which order you read the books in, or should I just kind of get...
No, let's start with Rogers.
Rogers?
He's easier. Yeah, I mean, Rogers is a very useful thinker, practically. So that's Carl Rogers, the psychotherapist. I'd recommend his writings. He wrote a book called A Way of Being, which is really a great book. It's very practical, you know. Rogers was a very practical person, and I think a good person. But it's very clear. Freud is harder, and Jung is impossible. But it's worthwhile. But very terrifying.
I bought the red book.
Oh yeah, no, you don't want to start with that. Yeah, no. That's advanced mysticism.
Yeah.
That's partly why he didn't publish it. I mean, he didn't publish it in his lifetime.
Yeah.
So there's a reading list on my
yeah.
website. And
okay.
The best thing, if you're interested in psychological theory, I think the best book, likely, especially psychoanalytic theory, is a book called The Discovery of the Unconscious. And that'll give you an introduction to Freud and Jung and Adler, and also to the history of psychoanalytic thought. It's a brilliant book. And it's really quite an engrossing read as well. So that's a really good place to start.
We have time for,
thank you
very much. We have time for one last question.
Okay. Okay, who's the girl? Who's there? We go. All right.
You said recently that you'll never grow up until you have your own children.
Yeah.
Coming from a woman who doesn't have any children, but is trying to sort herself
yeah.
out and has mental issues in their history. Is it more important to sort yourself out and do the best you can and try to get to adulthood in that way? Or is it really necessary to have kids?
Well, look, you know, this is something Carl Jung said about psychotherapy. He said that it could be replaced by a supreme moral effort. Because Jung, like most of the great psychologists, knew that a lot of what deranges people in their life is falsehood. You know, Freud talked about repression, and Alfred Adler talked about the life lie, and Carl Rogers talked about inauthenticity, and so did the existential psychotherapists. They all had their finger on the idea that to straighten yourself out is a moral effort. The thing about having kids that's telling is that if you have a child, then it's almost inevitable that you will then come to regard someone else as more important than you. And like, I think you can do that otherwise. There's other routes to that, but they're hard. I mean, because there isn't anything that's a bigger commitment, or there are very few things that are a bigger commitment than having a child. And so it forces, it catalyzes a change in you that you're entirely prepared for. And I think there are ways of doing that for people who don't have children. It's like, but it's
hard.
That's right. It requires the same sort of effort, I would say, that having a child requires, which is a lot of effort, you know? So, but, and when I make statements like that, they have to be, you know, they're punchy and generalized. And it's not to say that there are no people who are mature that don't have children, but the fastest and most certain way to maturity for people is to have a child. That also doesn't mean that everyone who has a child becomes mature, so because they don't. But generally, they at least become more mature than they were, which is something. We have to abandon the theater.
Right.